teamwork. Amen. Please be seated. Set us free! Oh my God, did you hear that in the call out today? Set us free! I was so excited about the first lesson that I stood at the very end of it because I was like, yes, God, yes. Yes, I want to believe in all of these things. Yes, I'm going to give you a rousing standing ovation right now, God. Let's do it. So take the bulletin home. Take a look at the lesson from Isaiah. Take a look at the gospel because it's very clear and it's very simple. Pray with it every day this week and just see what happens. Because it's simple, everybody. Friends, how many of us have them? Friends, friends we can depend on. This is a song that my kids are listening to right now. We've got Trolls, the playlist on kind of like repeat. And it's this whole medley of all these songs that talk about friends. The gospel today is about befriending. Again, very simple, but let's be honest. I don't know about you, but when I was in high school, friends, that was hard. So I get it when I'm up here, and I'm not saying it's simple to make friends. I'm saying that God's strategy for us to be a better people and a better loving, kind place for other people is really direct. Let's just be friends. Because if we were friends, then you would worry about the things that I worry about. If we were friends and something happened to my country, my neighborhood, and a big, huge earthquake happened, you would want to get me water or food or a place to live or something. If we were friends, I would probably expect a heart card on Tuesday. Just saying, I would love to receive it. So, why do we celebrate Absalom Jones today? That's kind of a big question. I may not be able to answer it today, but I want to show you something that I got from a friend of mine. Right down here, some of you may see it. There is a picture, and choir, maybe you can walk around later for communion, you can see it. But there's a person's arms that are shackled, and it says hashtag, what does it say, Sarah?
Beyond prison.
Yay! Not that you can read, but yay, thank you. Everybody, people can see it, right? Beyond prisons. Beyond prisons. A friend of mine in 2016 gave me this gift, and I have it in my office to remind me what kind of friend I want to be. Now, this friend at the time, when he gifted me this, I was his former teacher. So, this friend of mine was a senior in high school. He went to a justice conference that our school was a part of. He was moved by a story of somebody who was locked up in a box about 6 feet by 6 feet. It's called solitary confinement. And as a high schooler, he was moved with compassion. That's the gift that our high schoolers have. They're moved to compassion. He was so moved that it changed his life. He wanted to share it with the whole school. So we opened up the chapel, invited the classrooms. They came in and they shared the story of how they were moved by hearing the story of people who were imprisoned. We can add the layers of false imprisonment and all that, but just imprisoned. So my friend continues this work upon graduation, wants to study in college, wants to have internships. Years later, approximately 4 or so after he gets a degree, he takes his internship with an organization called Cut 50. Out of all the 50 states, if we were to reduce the criminalization of a number of crimes that disproportionately place particularly black and brown bodies behind cages, what would that world look like? So they are advancing the cause of human community by rejoining us in our communities and not imprisoning people. So it's called Cut 50. He had a blast with all the mentors, these activists, these people who are really working to break the shackles off of friends and people in their family that were impacted. I paused and I wanted to say that because I didn't know those words when I was in high school. I learned in that same trip when I was with him, when he was a senior in high school and I was not. And I say that now because as a friend, he reminds me every single day because he gave me a gift. And he gave me this poster. And he put it in my office so that I can, from that perspective, talk about God's love, talk about God's justice, and live into our call, my call, as a person of faith. So why celebrate Absalom Jones, the first black priest? One, because he's an anomaly. That's amazing. He was enslaved, and he became a priest. And we're celebrating him in one of the lesser feasts. Like, boy, isn't that amazing? He is also an example of black excellence. This idea and mindset that, particularly for people who have been on the losing end of society, that people can still prove to be quite successful. Or the stories and the narratives that we hear of slavery or history are only one-sided and there's another story. Or three, we celebrate Absalom Jones because it's Black History Month, everybody. It's February. And we want to know more about people who have persevered before us. So we want to stand on their shoulders and we want to mimic their life. All three really good reasons to celebrate Absalom Jones today. For those of you, well, I don't want to quiz you, but I didn't know much about Absalom before I was given him to reflect on today. Just being honest. So I bought books, I looked at Wikipedia, I looked at Google, like all these things. There's a book that's going around the children's area over there, and a couple black historians in the Episcopal Church put together a storybook of Absalom Jones. If you're curious, I'd love to get one for you because it is fascinating to hear this story of this man. Tangentially though, can I just say, I'm gonna name the obvious, two obvious things for me. One, if anything I say right now in particular causes you to be uncomfortable, or even tempted to tune out, or tense up, just notice it and don't judge it. Go ahead, be tense this entire sermon. Right, and then let it out, like that. Or move, or just notice that you are feeling tense because I wonder if God is just tapping you just a little bit to pay attention, to cooperate, to participate, to something, I don't know what it is, but just pay attention to that and just hold it. Don't judge yourself, I'm not judging you. You can probably judge me in my sermon, that's totally fine. I'll take it. But I'm not gonna judge you for your discomfort. But I need you to be there. I need you to recognize that it could possibly be it. So that's one. And then two, I obviously wanna mention the fact that today is a great American holiday, everybody. Yes, I am talking about the 57th Super Bowl. Yes, of course, you came here because you wanted me talk about the Super Bowl. No, probably not. And you're probably going to come to the Evensong in defiance of the Super Bowl. So thank you, everybody. Hashtag superb owl, Evensong. All right, but I did want to mention that because I find that there's an interesting moment, because there's a moment in history that is currently happening at 3:30 Pacific time today. Does anyone know what first is happening today? Yes, Chris.
Female pilot,
Lyle. Oh, that's cool.
Go Navy.
That's awesome. Go Navy. Okay, I didn't know that. Thank you. That's totally fun and will maybe skew this sermon. But no, that was not the first that I was thinking of. But I love that. I love that we can hold a whole series of firsts in this moment, right? The first that I'm actually thinking of is that Jalen Hurts from Philadelphia Eagles So these firsts are hard for me. Like, I want to celebrate, and I also know that it sends a mixed message. So I do not want to unpack Absalom Jones, all of his contributions to the church and society in that framework of, you know, he was a great human and personal achievement and we should follow him. I don't want to do it that way. Instead, I want to offer some suggestions as we think through and possibly feel our ways of being with one another as friends and how God may be tapping us. Because we too, here at St. Paul's in Burlingame, dare I say, can be a part of Black liberation. Set us free, all of us, even if we're not here. Please set us free. So one, God's companionship gives all of us life. Two, Jesus' way of love is not sentimental. And we know this from the Episcopal Church, from presiding Bishop Curry, Michael Curry. Love is an action, it's not a sentiment, everybody. And this one I probably think is the most important one for us to think about. The people most harmed by our current system or systems are uniquely qualified to create and champion the solutions that will begin to transform it. The people most harmed by our current system are uniquely qualified to create and champion the solutions that will begin to transform it. You may not have been paying attention, but I do because I like to think of the highlights of my time here at St. Paul's and as I've been allowed and received into giving some words on the gospel to you all, I have reflected on three men in church history. Before Christmas, it was Joseph, right? So I spent a lot of time with Joseph. And then I spent a little time with Ananias when Bill Phillips and Sarah and I did a little conversation on St. Paul's Day. And now I'm spending time with Absalom. So let me just share a couple things about this exercise for me. All have exercised their faith in God that is beyond their understanding. Joseph, Ananias, Absalom. In fact, some people may say that this God of justice, love, and reconciliation, and expansiveness, this God that they believed in, was a little cruel to them because there were consequences to their actions. So Joseph must have lived in society's judgment of how he continued to be in relationship with Mary and fathered a child out of wedlock. Ananias was transformed ever more deeply into a reconciling friend, but he needed to take a risk with all these people who believed in Jesus and Jesus' way. He took a risk to lay his hands on Saul, who was killing them. What were his friends thinking about who he was then? He took a risk. And now Absalom. Born into the economic system of slavery, born into a society that believed inherently that white people, again, this is not about you, I'm just saying, watch yourself, catch it. It's not about you, it's not about me. There used to be a system that this country was founded on called slavery, an economic system where white people were better than black people. In fact, black people were property and had no rights of their own. Absalom demonstrates a profound trust in God's saving ways, literally saving him out of that pit of darkness, or pit of persecution, or pit of limitation. That God's mercies were for those most oppressed, most hurt, most discarded in society, and that God would set captives free. So let's be clear. These three men in particular had deep, deep faith in God. But a God who does what? A God who is who? Read your first lesson again. That's the God that they believed in. Set us free. Let us be reminded. Who is the God that you believe in? the companion too. Two, Jesus' way of love is not a sentiment. You know, like, love, 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 sure. And what else? God's love is an active relationship. I feel like I don't need to spend time with that on you, with you all. You get it. It's an active relationship. You can't love somebody without knowing them, right? I also would like to think that, like Absalom Jones, he knew that he had a moral duty to help his neighbors. And because he, too, learned how to read on his own, he, in fact, read the Bible, like, three different times, you know, and that's what was shaping his imagination. He had a responsibility to help other freed slaves or slaves to read so that they can continue, literally control of their life again and buy back their life so they would save up their money. He bought his wife out of slavery, and then he bought himself out. He bought his wife out of slavery and then bought himself out. Love is shown in sacrifice. Hers first and then him. So for him, love was a strategy of human advancement. I love you so much, I want you to be free. I'm going to help you read. Like he did that twice a week. Help to tutor people. I love you so much, I want you to be free, that I will listen and try to offer you peace. His namesake, Absalom, is father of peace. And so he would make these visits, and everyone felt encouraged. That's what, you know, a few of the sources said. They felt encouraged. His priestly role of visiting people encouraged people. This is a guy who used to be a slave, who is desperately trying to seek freedom, but he's seeking freedom for everyone else first, and then himself. So yeah, we too can be part of Black liberation. Three, the people most harmed by our current system are uniquely qualified to create and champion the solutions that will begin to transform them. Last year I took a few classes. One of them was from the Howard Divinity School, where they brought together a lot of, you know, people like me in the trenches of a church, but also in communities. And in front of us, the teachers of that course were men who particularly served time in jail, who then went on to get their MDivs, who then went on to do other things, but a mark on their identity, personality, and how they viewed the world was because they too were in cages, in American cages that we created. I don't have to say how moving that was, but I will tell you how moving that was, because I think it's important to remember who are our teachers, who are our friends, whose lives do we listen to, even though we may be afraid or scared about what the consequences are. The class was theology and racialized policing and justice. So again, we can, in our minds, be so like, oh God, Jocelyn is getting political, which I am, because as a political scientist, I'm like, life is political, everybody. We're organizing ourselves constantly. And I want to organize myself on a firm foundation of faith in a God that I believe in, that I believe will set us free, all of us. And that looks like something in my community. That looks like something in our neighborhoods. That looks like something in our world. So how would we invest in the empowerment and the liberation of our neighbors? There's a story of Absalom Jones who, you know, takes his gift and goes into this church, and he's allowed to preach, and he's allowed to, you know, bring in some people. So the church started getting more Black people. And he and his friend Richard Allen would preach and preach and preach, and then they would tutor, they would help people save their money and free more people. And then the church, the particularly in that time was a white church, they're like, oh yeah, you can't be doing that here. So they kicked them out. They kicked them out, and that's how Richard Allen started the AME church. And then Absalom Jones stayed in the Episcopal tradition, trying to figure out his place with a bunch of other people too. And he found another church, and they quote-unquote allowed him to help to do this, right? It's just a little line in the story, and it makes me wonder, can St. Paul's be like a community like that? Can we have a sentence in somebody else's story? Can it like be read somewhere sometime, right? Like, I want to be a part of a community that's remembered in a story like Absalom's. Like, when so-and-so came to Burlingame, they tutored children of newly immigrant families at St. Paul's. Or with support from St. Paul's, comma, so-and-so was able to pay for all of their legal team to get their charges reversed and get them off of death row. So what is our dream for the world, everybody, and how does that align with God's? In 2010, Michelle Alexander wrote a book called The New Jim Crow, and this is what she says. We could choose to be a nation that extends care, compassion, and concern to those who are locked up and locked out or headed for prison before they are old enough to vote. We could seek for them the same opportunities we seek for our own children. We can treat them like one of us. We could do that. If we prayed with and discerned with Absalom Jones, what would we be doing for one another? What would we be doing here in Burlingame, in San Mateo, in this nation? Where can we be enlivened by God's desires for newness, aliveness in our own life? And how are we a minor or major player in their story towards liberation?